talking about like your early days of Fantagraphics, I mean,
oh brother,
yeah, it seems like there's a difference between what were the challenges just getting things up and running from a practical standpoint.
Well, you mean like from the very beginning, or yeah. Well, the challenges were always money. The challenges are still money. I never had any money. I came from a middle-class family. And so we started with no money. And so the challenge was, how do we do this without any money? And I mean, I don't know if it was easier back then than it is now. I mean, it could be a wash with the internet. But back then, I went to a local printer. We were working in the Washington, D.C. area. That's where I grew up. So we were working out of there. And I went to a local printer and I begged credit. I mean, I just asked him if he could give us credit so we could publish this tabloid-sized periodical. And for whatever reason, he did. And so that's how we started. We literally got credit from a printer. I had a setup in my two-bedroom apartment where I literally could sit down and paste up pages, and I could type on my typewriter and cut those out and lay them on board and create the boards that you know no one creates anymore with computers. And so we could do all of that ourselves, but we couldn't print the magazine ourselves. So we got credit, we printed the magazine, but we did everything ourselves. I mean it's probably no different than today. My partner at the time, Mike Katcher, and I would literally work 12, 16 hours a day, putting the thing together, stapling it together, mailing it, and also working either a part or full-time job so we could stay alive. Because I published fanzines when I was a teenager, I literally had the drawing board and all the equipment I needed. I mean, by equipment, I mean things like X-Acto knives and rubber cement and things like that, and a Selectric typewriter. And I had developed the skills to just put a magazine together, so I could do all that. So once I got a printer who was willing to give us credit, it was relatively easy, and we loved doing it. We loved actually shaping a magazine, putting it all together, putting all the elements together, creating headlines. From sheets of rub-on lettering. You're too young to remember any of this, but it was all, pre-computer. I literally had to type things on a typewriter in columns and then run down to the local Xerox center and have them reduced so I could paste up the reduced versions of it on board. So all that was doable. And then slowly, we accrued more credit, more cash flow, and we were able to, publish comics.
How did you get them to fans, to shops?
Okay, well, there was a growing, 1976. By 1976, comic shops were growing throughout the country. Let me try to put this succinctly for you. There were comic shops throughout the country. There were essentially two distributors, one on the East Coast, one on the West Coast. There was Phil Sewling on the East Coast and Bud Plant on the West Coast. And they developed a distribution system where they would buy directly from the publisher and then send it on a non-returnable basis directly to retailers. And so we just basically tapped into that system. And I knew both of these guys from my fan days. Phil Sewling ran the biggest comic convention in the country, the New York Comic Art Convention in Manhattan. And Bud Plant ran a big kind of underground distribution system on the West Coast. So I knew both of them. And when we started publishing the magazine, I approached them and just asked them if they'd be willing to take it. And they agreed to. This was after a year of our struggling, trying to make it by selling it only through the mail. So once we tapped into that system and got into the rhythm of it, we could publish more things and have those distributed in the same way. I mean, it was very informal. There were no contracts. He basically just told them, we're going to be publishing this, and somehow they told their retailers, and somehow they accrued orders. In fact, I think for the first couple of years, they simply took thousands of copies of the Comics Journal without knowing how many copies they would actually distribute. It was that informal a process. And I think for many, many years they were having, pallets of Comics Journals in their warehouse they were getting rid of because they overordered. And then throughout the 1980s, it became a much more formal system. More distributors started coming in until there were 6, 7, 8 distributors at any given time. And then it became a much more formal process.
Thanks for watching. Click here to subscribe.